Universal Studios Florida and Universal Studios Hollywood, like many theme parks, are in a constant state of change as rides are swapped out to entice repeat visitors from around the world. So in May of 2008, each park marked the opening of the Simpsons Ride, a technologically updated high-thrill adventure that would quickly turn into a runaway hit. Welcome to Amusement Labs, where today I'll show you the history, engineering, and technology behind the ride system and effects of the Simpsons Ride. This video is sponsored by generous patrons, especially Levi Valentine, Felix Montesa, and Brandon Wiggins at patreon.com/amusementlabs. Located at Universal Studios Florida in Orlando and Universal Studios Hollywood in California, the Simpsons Ride is a projection and motion-based simulator dark ride located in the Springfield area of both parks. This 4.5-minute ride drops guests right in the cartoonish chaos of the long-running animated sitcom The Simpsons. Riders are loaded into 8-seater cars and thrust into the madness, featuring cameos by nearly 2 dozen serious characters on an escape from Sideshow Bob through Krusty Land and around Springfield. Universal began the process of bringing the Simpsons Ride to both parks back in 2006 by closing the then nearly 15-year-old Back to the Future the Ride, even though the new ride was not yet formalized. Each building received a massive overhaul, converting the gray Institute of Future Technology to Krusty Land, painting the entire building purple with red ornaments. The plot begins when guests enter a carnival-style rendition of Krusty Land, Krusty the Clown's infamous, completely safe and family-friendly amusement park. After queuing and being sent to one of 3 floors, you arrive at a staging area where Krusty explains that Sideshow Bob, a disgruntled former employee who framed Krusty for robbery but was foiled by Bart Simpson, has escaped. After this, guests are separated into groups of 8 and sent to a pre-boarding room where the remainder of the story is shown. The Simpsons are being shown into the heart of Krusty Land, an unlicensed and poorly maintained nuclear power plant, before being led to the new upsy-downsy spins-aroundsy teen-operated thrill ride. After sneaking in, Sideshow Bob threatens the Simpsons into the ride while knocking Krusty unconscious, and then turns his attention to riders.
No last thing you'll ever see! A leader of biotech.
Guests are then directed into the main ride pod, where they're seated in the main ride vehicle, secured with a top-position lap bar. The doors then swing down from above and guests wait for the ride to begin. Instead of a large, gaudy coaster car, guests are actually loading onto a 4-degree of freedom hydraulic motion platform, one of the things Universal saw the need to replace during the transition from Back to the Future the Ride is the motion platforms themselves. Having originally been built in 1991, the original motion platforms and lift systems had become a bit antiquated and were in need of a full refurb, but given their age, it was more reasonable to upgrade to something more advanced and reliable. So during the transition, the original equipment actually built by Intamin was removed and overhauled with new systems made by Oceaneering. If you watched some of my videos before, you may recognize them from their work on a number of notable Universal attractions. Costing $30 million in Florida and $40 million in Hollywood, these transitions saw the installation of 24 Oceaneering systems at each park. Each ride contains 2 theaters with 12 motion platforms each, arranged in 3 levels, with 5 at the top, 4 in the middle, and 3 at the bottom. This is how the motion platforms work. The cars riders are seated in feature small speakers for a small bit of audio during the ride. The cars also feature lights, cameras to monitor riders, and vents to pump in scents such as baby powder later in the ride. All of this is mounted onto a frame that moves up and down, tilts forward, back, and side to side dynamically during the ride. The frame that the car is bolted to is fixed to 3 AA frame hinges connected to the center of the car frame and onto the base frame of the motion system. These physical hinges secure the car and allow for tilting and vertical motion. The car is manipulated in these directions by 3 hydraulic actuators connected using universal joints connected to the bottom of the frame of the car and the base of the motion platform. The actuators are arranged with 1 under the front of the car and 2 under the back of the car for stability. These hydraulic actuators are more reliable, precise, and powerful than pneumatic actuators, which also helps with the ever-changing load of riders. However, Earlier I mentioned that these platforms have 4 degrees of freedom, and that's because the entire platform sits on a linear sled comprised of 2 linear guides, with yet another hydraulic actuator moving the entire 3 actuator and car setup forward and back during the ride. However, to reduce weight, this linear sled also slides the car out from the false back panel of the car, leaving the heavy part behind, making the setup a lot more stable. But the entire ride system adds yet another layer of complexity, as the entire system, the car, the doors, the 3 actuator platform, and the linear sled system is placed on top of a 10-foot vertical lift system. The electronics and controls for the car are all connected to a branching computer system through an umbilical cable cord that hangs safely down from the car while it's in the air. This lift system uses a hydraulic scissor lift, something you may have seen in construction or other fields. This Oceaneering-built scissor lift uses an extremely powerful actuator to push the 2 bottom ends attached to the ground with 1 attached to the actuator closer together, which raises the entire assembly up out of the load pit riders boarded in, through a big hole in the ceiling. One of the unique and expensive parts about the ride that Universal was keen on keeping was the 85-foot tall full IMAX dome that completely envelops the view of riders and each of the 2 theaters. When the ride starts, a custom-made ride video produced by Blur Studios and Real Effects is projected onto the perforated white dome. It's made in such a way that regardless if riders are sitting in the rightmost car of the theater or the leftmost car, their view will be basically the same due to the sheer size and scale of the dome compared to the cars. Each theater uses 4 overlapping 4K Sony projectors that shine out from the middle level, which is why there are only 4 cars on the middle level instead of 5 like above. When the lifts reach their peak, pushing riders up to see the dome, 2 stabilizer arms, 1 on each side, flip down away from the car so that it can begin moving. After rising up from below, we roll forward, bumping the Simpsons, which is aided by the linear sled to provide the sensation that we've impacted their car. We roll forward onto the rest of the roller coaster as Sideshow Bob attempts to smash the Simpsons with a wrecking ball. After launching off a broken track section, we take a magical journey through Krusty's mouth, where the motions become more mild until Bob grabs us again as we're thrust down the ride's suspended track rather forcefully. We then fall into the river onto a pirate dinosaur themed boat ride that's definitely not a jab at another ride somewhere else down the road. As we accelerate forward into the film, the linear sled pushes the car forward and tilts it upward slightly to lay riders a bit on their backs as if they're accelerating in a vehicle. We then break out, falling down a pit nearing hell, only to be saved and slung to downtown Springfield, where Bob is holding Maggie's pacifier until she destroys Springfield. Maggie then mistakes us for her pacifier, and there the linear sled benefits from being hydraulic by being able to oscillate in reverse direction quickly and forcefully compared to traditional actuators. The Simpsons escape to their iconic couch gag only to be strapped in by Kang and Kodos, who turn their home into Death Drop, reminding them that
"Don't you know all rides must end near the gift shop?"
The car briefly illuminates riders to take their photo as we pass the Simpsons on the way down, landing in front of Sideshow Bob. Looking for a quick kill, Bob turns to riders, but the Simpsons crash down on top of him at the last second. Maggie then pushes over an archway to Krusty Land, ending the ride as the car stabilizers come back up to hold the car and the lift lowers riders back down. Orange LED lights and fake fire and smoke come out of the walls and the linear sled slides the car back into the false back of the car after Krusty presses the emergency button, which vibrates the car. The ride is finally over and riders can now unload. The Simpsons ride, despite its critics, would go on to be a huge success for both parks by attracting the younger and older fans of The Simpsons. Each park would later develop and construct mini Springfield-themed areas around the rides, bringing in themed restaurants like Moe's and Krusty Burger, and the infamous Duff Beer, which is actually only available at Universal Parks. This well-thought-out and entertaining experience cleverly reuses as much as it can from Back to the Future the ride to provide fans of the show a thrilling way to journey into Springfield and be dropped right into the action. The technology behind the ride alone is both convincing, reliable, modern, and shows Universal's commitment to technological immersion and change in a number of ways. And that's how the Simpsons ride works. If you like this video, please subscribe. And while we don't end near the gift shop, please do consider joining our Patreon for early access to videos like this and more. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the parks.